Horizon Chat, Swarm City UX, and this is 22 versus 500. America's Defiant standard, Lanzerath Ridge. Is that how you say it? Yeah. This was some Federation, obviously. The new Federation video was posted 2 days ago or something. Yeah. So this is going to be one of those like badass scenario. But I remember watching one of the first video I watched from Federation. About a badass guy, basically badass marine. I think it was badass marine fighting in, I think, in China, right? I'm pretty sure. I don't know. I'm pretty sure fighting in China and going against you know, like hordes of people, where his own team thought that he's dead, but when they went back, oh, by the way, everyone's dead besides him. So that's some insane shit. I'm guessing this is similar to that. 22 versus 500. So yeah, there is no named protagonist so far on the title. So I don't know if it's just going to be one guy or multiple people who are like badass. But it's going to be interesting. Let's watch it.
All right, the most decorated platoon of World War II.
Platoon.
Today we're talking about the Battle of Lanzerath Ridge, when 22 American soldiers stood their ground against 500 German paratroopers and quite possibly changed the entire outcome of the Second World War, and they didn't even know it. But first, a word from our sponsor. What is happening right now?
Delete me.
We're not going to use the new couch?
No, the small one's iconic. Plus the big one hurts.
Yes.
Anyway, where do you want this thing?
Coffee table.
Will the audience be able to see it?
Yeah, I got a thing for that. Look at this.
Really? A spotlight for the IRS?
Ooh, I didn't think about that part.
You're extra.
Love you. Mm-hmm. Anyways, delete me. Super straightforward business. You give them money.
Did he change house or did he just change his position? Wasn't he the same? I don't know. I don't remember what, you know, his lock in the background, but that he could have just moved that. I don't know.
They turn around and they make sure the data brokers aren't selling your personal information on the internet. So here's how this happens. Pretty much anytime you use a free app or internet service, that app or service isn't actually free. What they're doing is they're harvesting your personal information, then they turn around, they sell it to data brokers, and then the data brokers sell it to anybody that has money. The good news is these data brokers are legally required to stop selling your personal information if you formally ask them to. The problem is there's a bunch of different data brokers and they all have a different process for you to formally request that they quit selling your information. That's where Delete Me comes in. Delete Me monitors all the biggest data brokers for your personal information, and as soon as it comes up for sale, they automatically write in and have them take it down as soon as possible. And then as long as you're subscribed to Delete Me, they will continue to monitor, checking and rechecking for your personal information at these data brokers over and over and over again to make sure if they do ever come in contact with your data again, they have to delete it again. So if that's something you'd be interested in, I will have a link and a discount code down below. Let's get back to the video. All right, important background info. September 1944, things are not going well for Germany in World War II at this point. On the east, they have the Soviet Union Red Army closing in, and on the west, they have the Allied forces closing in as well. At this point, the Allied forces have already stormed the beach at Normandy, they've retaken North Africa, they've retaken France and Belgium, and now Allied forces are right up on the German border at the Siegfried Line. It is Germany's last line of defense, their western wall, almost 400 miles of dragon's teeth, tank traps, mines, barbed wire, and it's all covered by over 18,000 concrete reinforced bunkers with artillery and machine guns. And it is the advice of almost every high-ranking German officer that Hitler should order his men to hunker down and defend throughout the winter. But Hitler has a different idea. Hitler wants to do the exact...
Yeah, that scene from that movie, how much of a meme that has become. Like, it's like a really old thing, but like people are like constantly putting subtitles there. For anyone who doesn't understand German, I guess, and there you go. You can just make people who understand German, that must be very weird. Like, you know what he's saying, but like subtitles say something different.
Opposite. He wants to go home with the girl that he took to prom, so to speak. Hitler got here by being overtly aggressive. He attacked Poland and then he launched the Blitz to take over France. He attacked quickly and violently to a degree that nobody had ever seen before, taking everybody off guard. They literally called his tactics the Blitzkrieg, the Lightning War, and he wants to do that again. Rather than playing defense and waiting for the enemy to come to them, he wants to go to the enemy. He wants to launch a major offensive, and the German military only has one left in them. This is an all-or-nothing strategy, and if he fails, the war is essentially over, but that's not going to deter him. You see, along the Western Front, you have the British and the Canadians in the north, and you have the Americans in the south, and it is Hitler's strategy to launch another Blitzkrieg-style attack right down the middle, splitting the British and the Canadians from the Americans, separating the Allied forces.
Yeah, Hitler has been really effective with that strategy, right? I remember watching those videos who just like shows you real time, like map graph type of thing, like how they captured places. And it's what surprised me is like, you know, Germans, basically Nazi Germany at the time, constantly attacking like Soviets and like, or, you know, in eastern side, west side, like, you know, the Allies and like Soviet Union east side, right? Like constantly, like, you know, like encircling them, and suddenly like a prisoner of war, right? And suddenly, like, you see this like graph going up, like, oh, why are those spikes going up like that? But they're trying to entrap them, and suddenly like closes in and like you're prisoners of war. He was insanely effective at that. So him just thinking of that strategy, okay, let's cut them off like that and like try to trap them, that would work. Because he has done that a lot.
After splitting the Allied forces, he wants to drive the Canadians and the British to Antwerp, essentially pushing them up against the sea, creating another Dunkirk-type situation, forcing the British and Canadians to surrender, and then he hopes to broker a peace deal with America, because America won't want to be the only Allied force left fighting them. Assuming that plan works, he will no longer have a Western Front to defend, and he will be able to divert his entire military to the Eastern Front to combat the Red Army. This is a Hail Mary. This is an all-or-nothing strategy, and the Germans need everything to go right if they want any chance of success. They need the weather to comply, and they need the element of surprise. Because of this, the entire offensive is going to need to run on a very tight timetable. Once they invade and knock the Allied forces on their heels, they're going to need to keep them on their heels the entire time until they've won. If even a single German unit gets hung up or delayed, it could throw off the timetable, allowing the Allied forces to regain a foothold and launch a successful defense and maybe even a counteroffensive. And that would essentially bring an end to World War II in the European theater, with the Nazis losing. The crazy part about a strategy that's this big and this time sensitive is that it could be just one small contingency of men led by one officer that's willing to fight to the bitter end, that could set about a chain reaction that would bring about the end of the entire Third Reich. And what's even crazier is Hitler would probably never even find out that dude's name.
So, yeah, okay.
Lyle Bauck was born on December 17th, 1923 in Fenton, Missouri. He grew up during the Great Depression with five siblings. His father was a carpenter, and as I'm sure you can imagine, there wasn't a whole lot of new construction going on during the Great Depression, so he grew up in what many of us would consider to be soul-crushing poverty. Luckily, ignorance is bliss, and young Lyle was just a kid. Whatever he experienced was normal to him. He had no idea that it was irregular for a family that large to live in a one-bedroom home with no electricity and no plumbing. He didn't know that it wasn't normal that—
Yeah, that's the fucked up thing about it, right? I wonder about this all the time, like in places in North Korea, right? Those videos, there are a lot of videos on YouTube about information, like how North Korea basically has close to no electricity. You see those night shots, and North Korea is mostly dark, besides some big cities like Pyongyang and things like that, right? And like people, and also it's like closed wall, right? Like they only see what North Korea wants them to see. So, you know, they probably don't even know what it is to be, you know, anything else. Right? What is normal? What is prosperity? How other people live? Right? Technology and things, smartphones, and this must be so weird, right? So that's a fucked up thing about it. They might not even know what they're missing and not missing, right? People always question, like, okay, why are the people in North Korea like putting up with all this shit? Why are they not revolting? In order to revolt, you need to know some things different, right? When everything just cut off and this is the world you live in, this is the world you live in. Like, you don't even see anything different. You need something to compare to.
That nobody was full after dinner, and that all the siblings would go out to eat dandelions and wild berries for dessert. But as he got older, he started to fully understand his family's situation, and by the time he was 14, he wanted to help. So he went and he enlisted in the Missouri National Guard, where he would be able to make $1 a day every time he had drill. In the Army, Lyle's basically a prodigy. He's incredibly intelligent, he's great at everything he does, and he grew up some poor depression kid eating dandelions in his backyard, right? There's nothing the Army can do to him that his childhood hasn't already done, and he deemed his childhood as a good time, so all of this is just fun to him, no matter how much it would suck to anybody else. By the time he's 16 years old, he is the supply sergeant for his entire unit, and in December of 1940, as World War II is starting to heat up, America has not entered the war yet, but it's looking like we're gonna. They're starting to draft people. His entire reserve unit gets activated to go do a bunch of training. So Babcock and his unit are down in Texas and Louisiana. They're training for a full year. They go from December 1940 till December of 1941. Early December rolls around. They're getting ready. They're packing their shit. They're going to go back home. They've been gone for an entire year. Japanese attack Pearl Harbor. They're not going home. They get told, congratulations, your active duty has been extended indefinitely. Don't worry though, it gets better. You see, the army in its infinite wisdom is like, okay, we've got this group of National Guard guys. They've been training for a full year. They're ready to go. They've been training in Texas and Louisiana. They're used to the heat. They're acclimated for the desert and the jungle with extreme humidity. Okay, where should we put them? And the army's like, the Aleutian Islands, aka fucking Alaska, which is just brilliant. Okay, so Bauk's unit is going to get sent up to the Aleutian Islands because they're concerned that the Japanese are now going to attack the West Coast, and one of the first places they would attack would be the Aleutian Islands, so they're basically going to be there ready to fight the Japanese if they come. So at this point, Bauk is like, I would rather do literally anything else. So he goes and he volunteers for OCS school, and he volunteers for this new sketchy job called being a paratrooper. And OCS school gets back to him first, which is the officer training course. He gets shipped off to school to become an officer. So about
yeah, when you see the globe, right, people see the 2D square map of the world, or rectangle, whatever, that flat map, and people have this warped sense of like how places are. So if you see like then you see like, okay, Japanese from the Pacific gonna attack Alaska. Why would they not just attack Los Angeles or something like that? It's just there. It's not there. When you see globe, right, you realize like how close Alaska is to Japan and things. It's just basically there. While, you know, mainland US is like much like, you know, deeper inside, right? Because of how globe is. If you like split apart globe like that and put it on paper, yes, it will all look like that. So Alaska was basically just there near Japan, right? You just have to like cross and yeah, you know, go north and basically there you go. So it kind of makes sense they're trying to defend Alaska and things.
Bauk ships off for Fort Benning. He's going to end up being an infantry officer. He goes through the course, graduates top of his class. He does so well, they end up retaining him and not shipping him off to war because they're going to use him as an instructor to train a bunch of more recruits that are coming through. So he actually ends up doing that for a year at Fort Benning, training small group defensive tactics for the infantry. So a year goes by. Bauk is 19 years old. He gets orders to go down to Camp Maxey, Texas. He's going to be joining the 99th Infantry Division before they get ready to ship off to combat. He's not really sure where they're shipping off to yet. Nobody knows if they're going to the Pacific Theater or the European Theater, but just judging on the fact that they're in Texas where it's warm and the European Theater is about to go into winter, it would make sense that he was going to the Pacific Theater, so he's starting to mentally get himself ready for that. So he gets down to Camp Maxey, and at this point in the war, it's like 1943, so most of the younger officers, Bauk's only 19 years old, he's a first lieutenant, and most of the junior officers that are young are all what's called a 90-day wonder, which basically means they pluck some kid out of college, sent him to officer training school for 90 days, and turn him around and sent him into combat to lead men into battle. So being called a 90-day wonder is like a derogatory term. It's definitely not a compliment. It's basically everybody in your chain of command being like, hey, I respect the rank you have on your chest, but also I have zero faith in your ability to do absolutely anything. So that's kind of what everybody just assumes Bauk is. He's so young, they look...
Basically calling somebody snowflake or something. It sounds good, but I don't think it's not a compliment.
Look at him, 19-year-old kid, first lieutenant on his chest, are like, 90-day wonder. In reality, Bauk has 5 solid years of experience already at 19 years old. He is one of, if not the most experienced junior officer in the United States Army at this point. His chain of command realizes this and they give him a more important task. He ends up getting tasked with standing up and creating the INR platoon, the Infantry and Reconnaissance Platoon, for the 394th Infantry Regiment of the 99th Infantry Division. Now, an INR platoon at this point is what we today would call a scout sniper platoon in the infantry. Basically, they take some of the better or the best infantry guys available from the entire regiment, stick them inside of this platoon, and they learn different tactics because they have a completely different job from the rest of the infantry. Their job is going to be going out behind enemy lines, surveilling the enemy, gathering intelligence, potentially capturing other enemy scouts, things of that nature. Bauk is basically told, hey, here's access to all the personnel files for the entire 99th Infantry Division. Pick your top 18 guys. You got to have 2 squads and 9. So he immediately goes through all the personnel records, starts picking guys out. His criteria is you have to be either a high school graduate or currently going to college. You have to have an IQ of 110 or higher. You have to be a qualified expert marksman with the M1 Grand, and you have to be physically fit. So he goes, he gets like a list of like 50 names, goes around talking to everybody, gets a bunch of volunteers. He ends up having 21 volunteers, but he only needs 18 men. So he has this little miniature selection process. Three of the men fall out. He's got his crew of 18. And from here, Bauk uses the rest of the time he has stateside to train the holy hell out of these 18 guys. Remember, he was an infantry instructor at Fort Benning for a year. This guy knows how to train people, and now he is overly...
Yeah, the IQ thing. I mean, that's interesting, right? Like, what is it? Like, below 80 is where military doesn't really recruit. And I'm pretty sure, like, they relax that rule, right? They relax that rule in, like, Vietnam times, if I remember correctly, yeah. But what happened was, like, they lost more and casualty was much higher than, you know, like, expected, right? And, like, overall, like, it was more for loss than anything gained. Right, so after that, military just realized, you know what, doesn't matter what, let's just keep the 80 rule, right? Let's not relax it. Because more loss of life, more money lost, more time wasted just to, you know, like train and everything. So a certain level of IQ below is just like, you're not going to work as a unit. You're not going to work overall, right? Every minute might be too important in a war. So like overall, that was an interesting experiment. And you know, people always like wonder about this, why 80, like isn't that like in military, why 80 is so important? Vietnam literally showed like why it is important, like you should not go below that.
Committed to 18 people specifically. He makes them do the hardest obstacle course at Camp Maxey every single morning. By the time they get done with training and get shipped off to war, this group of 18 is an excellent team and they are in phenomenal shape. And then one day they just get told, hey, pack your shit, head to the train yard, you're shipping off to war. They don't even tell these guys where they're going. Now at this point, you gotta remember, it's like late 1944. The Allied forces are dominating over in Europe. The German army is on its last leg. They've got the Germans pretty much pushed all the way back into Germany, and they're just manning the Siegfried line. Okay, so everybody's kind of hoping they're going to Europe, but also everybody kind of already knows they're going to the Pacific Theater. They've had these guys out training in the desert the entire time. It's just obvious they're going to send them over to that tropical environment, and they're going to have to go toe-to-toe with the Japanese, which is horrifying. So they all get to the train yard. Nobody tells them shit. They still don't know where they're going. Everybody's just kind of like, we're going to Japan. We've got to be going to Japan, right? They get in the train. Nobody tells them where they're going. And they're like, well, fuck it. I guess we'll know in a second when the train starts moving east or west.
All right. Is it horrifying because it's not decisive yet? Because like going against Nazi Germany is also like horrifying if going against Japan is. But I think the point here is like Germany was already losing at this point. That's the point. Yeah, it was a very weird time for America, isn't it? Like people like, oh, look at that. Nazi Germany is like losing. Like we pushed them all the way back. This war is might as well be over. Sigh and relief a bit for everyone in Europe and things, but America still had like war to fight against Japan in Pacific. The atomic, you know, the Oppenheimer thing is probably still going on, like they're researching all that shit. So yeah.
Because obviously, if we're going to the west, we're going to the Pacific Theater. If we're going to the east, we're going over to Europe. And sure enough, the train starts heading to the east coast. These boys are headed over to the European theater in winter, despite the fact that they're acclimated to living in a desert, which, I mean, it makes sense if you don't think about it. So the 99th Infantry Division gets over to Europe. They end up manning the Siegfried Line. The entire Siegfried Line on the Allied side is pretty sparsely defended. They're not anticipating the Germans are going to launch a counteroffensive and attack. So they're just kind of spread out, maintaining the area. They're going to let winter do some of the work for them because it's November in 1944. Let the Germans go in there, freeze their ass off. The Red Army's attacking them from the other front. Like, let's just wait a minute and chill is more or less a strategy. So a lot of the infantry guys on that front aren't doing a whole lot other than just securing that front line. But Bauk and the INR platoon are scouts. They're going to be going ahead and they're going to be actually scouting out the Siegfried Line. They're going to be making maps, getting spots of where all the bunkers are, where all the booby traps are, all the minefields, gathering all the intel and trying to capture German scouts and intelligence along the way. Now, because the INR platoon is going to be sneaking up on the enemy front lines trying to gather, their job is a little bit more dangerous, so Bauk wants to give him and his men the best firepower they can possibly get. So he goes out to the mechanics and the engineers and asks them to make some modifications to the INR platoon's M1 carbines.
Need more firepower.
If you don't know, the M1 carbine is semi-automatic and it has a 15-round magazine, so they go and they end up welding two magazines together to make a bunch of 30-round magazines, and then they modify the sears inside of the car. make them fully automatic. So now the INR platoon is going to be running around the woods in Germany with what amounts to a bunch of submachine guns. By December 1944, they're going out, they're doing missions. And one of the first missions, they wanted to take Private Leopold with them. Now, Private Leopold in the INR platoon is unique because he was actually from Germany. His family fled when the Nazis came to power because they were Jewish. So Private Leopold is extremely valuable because not only does he speak German, but he speaks German in a German accent. It's his native tongue. So he's going to be able to overhear Germans if they get close enough to spy on them, or if they capture one, he's going to be able to interrogate them. It's a very valuable asset to have. The problem is he's Jewish and he's from Germany. If he gets captured by the Nazis, it's pretty much a death sentence right out of the gate. And he's already being a scout, like the most forward infantry unit available, so his chances of being...
Yeah, because even if you're losing, Nazis are still going to be like as racist as they can, apparently, because that's their doctrine, I don't know. So even if you're losing, oh, by the way, that's Jewish, like, they're still going to focus on that point. Not that, oh, fuck me, we are losing, let's think about winning.
Caught or higher than virtually anybody else's. So he's not super keen on going out on missions unless he's feeling like he's at 100%. And on this particular day, he's sick and he's got a really bad cough. So Leopold goes to the chain of command and he's like, hey, I've got this really bad cough. I'm a scout. We're trying to like sneak up on the enemy. Maybe me coughing the entire time isn't going to work out that great. Also, I'd rather not get caught because I'm Jewish. What do you think? Can I sit this mission out? And the chain of command's like, I mean, you speak German, right? You'll cough in a German accent. It'll be fine.
Uh-oh. You okay there, Dennis?
So Leopold's like, fine, okay, I guess. So he goes out on this mission, immediately starts coughing the entire time. Bauk is like, Leopold, shut the fuck up. Start eating snow. So Leopold spends the entire mission just eating snow to calm his throat down so he's not coughing. Ends up working great. This is like their first mission out.
Yeah, I mean, that works, right? It's a surprising thing. People are like, don't eat ice cream or anything cold because that's what give you cold, because it's in the name, it's cold, but not really. First of all, changes of temperature is what gets you. And once you are like infected with these germs or virus, whatever, like whatever is germs, virus, whatever it is, right? Once you're infected, your throat's gonna get swelled up, right? So eating anything cold like ice cube or ice will basically like anti-inflammatory, isn't it? Just like, you know, make it less, you know, swollen, so you cough less, right? Usually people like tell you like, okay, if you have like throat issue, like, you know, suck on like ice cube or something, that will like, you know, make it less swell. But it's counterintuitive, the things you heard are like, oh, let's stay away from cold and things. People actually try to do warm things, right? And it might work later on when you need, you know, increased, you know, blood flow or something. But initially, it will make things much worse.
Together, and they come across a dead German soldier's body. At first, they're worried that it's a booby trap, so they sit there, they watch it for a while. There's no movement anywhere around it, so it's probably not an ambush. And then they sneak up on it, and they tie a rope around the ankle of the body, and then get as far away as they can before pulling it like 6 to 8 feet, just to make sure it's not booby trapped with like a grenade underneath it or something. And it's not. So they go, they search the body, they find an ID card, they find out what unit this guy's from, and they find some other intel on him. This is the first successful mission of the INR platoon. Couple days after that, they go out on another patrol. They end up running into a German patrol and then they immediately outgun them using their modified M1 carbines, and they end up wiping out the entire German patrol. So things are going great. The INR platoon is performing exactly how they trained to perform. They're going out, they're scouting, they're doing their job, they're getting it done. And what does the military do when things aren't broken? That's right, we fix them anyways. You know what would be cool? If the INR platoon, the intelligence and reconnaissance platoon, rather than going out and gathering intelligence and performing reconnaissance, what if we set them up in static fighting positions and ordered them to hold a point like every other infantry company on the planet?
It's a great idea, right?
It's a terrible idea.
So December 10th, Bauk's commanding officer rolls up and is like, hey, get in the Jeep. He drives Bauk out and he drives him to this little tiny village of like 15 houses and a cafe called Lanzerath. And Lanzerath has this main road running right through the top of it. Inside of Lanzerath, there's like...
I guess I can kind of see the point of view. Like, this is the base thing they're supposed to do. They can't hold out position, right? That's what they're supposed to do, soldiers. On top of that, they are like all this like intelligence gathering, all that. That's the implication here. And maybe the person thought like, okay, this place is like important, so I need to put people here that will hold out, and like logistically these are the best people I can put there without actually like making issues somewhere else, because if I move troops from somewhere else, it's gonna be a problem. So might as well do that type of way. Right, it might feel like weird, but when you think it like that, maybe there was a reason.
50 anti-tank soldiers and then like four forward observers, you know, the guys that call in the artillery. And then right on the other side of the town, there's this ridge with a wood line. And the commander's like, hey, I want you and your 18 guys to go ahead and hold this ridge on this wood line. We can't lose this town on the off chance that the Germans do attack, because this would be the best route for a bunch of tanks to come storming through. So Bauk and the INR platoon are not excited about this. This is not what they trained to do. It's not really their job. They don't have the training. And when you don't have the training, you get to do the most terrifying thing in the military. You get to wing it, and Bauk is gonna do just that. So obviously they're about to start stealing shit. Strategically transferring equipment to an alternate location.
The finest merchandise this time of ever shown on sale today. Come on down.
And the best way to go about that this time is to not actually steal it. It's actually to trade stuff that they've already stolen. I mean, acquired. You see, because the Iron Ore Platoon was one of the only units actually going out scouting and engaging German scouts, they were also some of the only men on the Western Front at this point in time that had gathered memorabilia, if you will. And let's face it, everybody wants a good souvenir, right? Including supply sergeants. So Bauk gathers up all their memorabilia, goes out to the supply sergeants. He ends up trading it. He ends up getting several Browning automatic rifles, a 30 caliber machine gun. And then he ends up trading some pretty substantial pieces of memorabilia and gets a Jeep that he then convinces the mechanics to weld tank plate armor onto.
Yeah, basically he's playing RPG game here, right? His 80 pound limit was like full. He didn't want to become encumbered or whatever. So he sold certain things, got guns, then went back again, gathered the loot, sold it again. Now he has a Jeep. There you go.
And mount a 50 caliber machine gun on top of, and he drives that out to Lanzerath. So the INR platoon gets all their new equipment. They head out to Lanzerath. There was a unit that was already there that had already dug foxholes, but their foxholes kind of sucked. They weren't very deep. So the INR platoon gets to work. They dig the foxholes way deeper. They go out in the woods and they cut down a bunch of 4 to 5 inch thick trees. They build it up on top and they cover the foxholes with wood as well. They camouflage the holy hell out of everything. They even dig a foxhole for the Jeep with a ramp to drive down into, so it has its own fortified fighting position. So while that's going on, Bauk goes down into town in Lanzerath. He wants to figure out everything that's going on. He wants to talk with the FOs, talk with the anti-tank guys, just get everything under control and know what's going on, right? He gets there, kind of a giant shit show. They've clearly been here for a while and there's not a whole lot going on. There's a family in town called the Schur family, and they're actually making hot food for all the Americans in exchange for chocolate and cigarettes. Now, the Schur family has already got their 25-year-old daughter sleeping in bed with the parents just so she stays away from all the American soldiers, and all the American soldiers have made her 16-year-old brother Adolf basically their mascot. He now speaks English, but only profanity. So with that, he goes back up to camp in his fortified fighting position, and they just kind of wait. They're there just making sure that the Germans don't attack, essentially, freezing their ass off. They've got a little heating shack. They're taking turns, rotating in and out, warming up, sleeping, eating food, and this goes on for a couple of days. By December 13th, this new guy rolls into town, some Belgian guy, acting kind of weird, so they, you know, stop him, they talk to him, they're like, what are you doing? And he's like, I'm bringing my cousin some shoes. And they're like, right, that's a fucking spy. And they're like debating on what to do with this guy. They can't really do shit with him, so they just end up letting him go. And from there, shit just gets weird. There's this like one corner of the area that they're overlooking with their fields of fire that they end up calling the creepy corner, because every single night something weird is going on over there, right? There's noises and nobody can see shit and they don't know what's going on over there. And eventually one night they're manning the positions and they hear snow, like freshly frozen snow. You know how when you step on it, it kind of got this big crunch sound as it breaks through. They hear that getting closer and closer and closer, and eventually they just open fire on it because it has to be someone or something coming right at it. And after they open fire, it's just quiet. And that was it for the rest of the night. They can hear some...
Yeah, they're naming it creepy or whatever. This is not you going with your friends in like woods or something and just make spooky stories and it's fun. This is war. At this time, only thing if I were there would think is rationally. And yeah, I would think like, noises don't just come out of nowhere. There's someone there. Maybe somebody, some Nazis just like figured shit out. And if that's a weird corner because weird shit is happening, which means maybe somebody's, something is onto us. Somebody's onto us, right? I would like focus on that place a lot more. If I hear the sound, yeah, I would open fire as well, because obviously there's somebody there. Why would the noises be there, right? Now if there's nobody there, there might be some kind of like a phenomenon, scientific phenomenon, I don't know. Some kind of like wind in whatever way just makes this creaking sound because snow breaks or something. I don't fucking know, right? I don't know the condition. But yeah, imagine that would panic you. You're not trying to think it any like weird way, like paranormal style way. You're just thinking rationally because it's war. Clearly, there's German. But if you shoot at it, there's nothing there. What the fuck are you supposed to think? On top of that, it's like, and not to mention, like, this is a war where millions of people have died, right? In 1940s, right? Your paranoia would basically get you, oh, something paranormal is probably, some kind of ghost is there because so many people died. Shit like that, people must think that, right? This is not some internet age. This is not some enlightening age or something. In 1940s, people thought about shit like this. Why not?
Grumbling off in the distance, but nothing else ever came. The next morning, they go out and they investigate, and it was a dog that they had ended up shooting, but it was clearly a military-trained dog, but it was by itself.
Hey, look at us.
Look at us. Huh? Who would have thought?
Not me.
Military-trained dogs are not going to be by themselves. So like I said, it wasn't some spooky place. It was spooky because clearly Nazis are onto them. They probably surveyed them from the distance and knows that this is a blind spot or something and tried to exploit that. Because why would it be like military-trained dog?
So that's weird. And then they adventure further past that, like 150, 200 yards. And then there's like ski tracks all over the place. And they're like, what the fuck is going on? So then the whole day goes by. Everything's seeming kind of normal.
What is it? Finland story about like the coked up guy who was skiing. So, you know, Nazis and like many different like soldiers used skis and things like that in ice just to get around. It must be some of the Nazis who figured shit out and was like reconnaissance or whatever.
Normal, a Jeep shows up to resupply him with more food, and this time around, they all got a liquor ration, which is like immediately a red flag. Like, they're only giving out liquor rations when they're about to ask us to do some dumb shit or something horrible is about to happen, okay? It's like getting a steak and lobster dinner. It's gonna happen right before somebody's about to die. They're not telling us something, and we need to figure out obviously what it is. But then somebody's like, hold on, maybe it's not that bad. Lieutenant Bauk actually turns 21 in 2 days on the 17th. So maybe it's so we can all have a party and get LT drunk. Then more creepy noises all night long. That morning, a deer walks into camp. Naturally, they shoot it with a machine gun. They end up eating it. Then normal day, seems like, okay? Night of the 15th, more creepy noises all night long. But tonight the noises are different. Off in the distance, it almost sounds like there's engines running. So Lieutenant Bauk knows something's up. So he has all the guys up. They're all alert. They're all there. And then on the day of the 16th at 5:30 a.m., they start getting hit with a ton of artillery fire right on top of them. At this point, the whole platoon and Lieutenant Bauk.
See, Nazis got to them in that weird spot, right? That's why there were like ski trucks there, because like people were like gathering info. There's no such thing as weird. There's reason behind everything. The dog wasn't just there by itself, right? Somebody was basically hiding and basically just like mistakenly sent the dog in, and the dog got shot and they basically sneaked away. No, obviously that's what happened here. No way is anything else.
They're all shit in their pants. I mean, they've had a couple of firefights off in the woods with like two or three Germans, but this time it's completely different. It feels like they're in the shit. It feels like they're at D-Day taking a ton of artillery fire.
500,
the rounds that are getting shot towards them are set to airburst, so they're blowing up in the tree line before they hit the ground, and it's just sending shards of tree splinters everywhere. So the entire Iron Ore platoon is just hiding inside their foxholes, and at this point, everybody's pretty fucking happy that Lieutenant Bauk made everybody cut down trees and put roofs over their foxholes, because now it's gonna take a direct hit to take anybody out. The artillery barrage just keeps coming and coming and more and more, and it gets to the point that like the adrenaline wears off and it just gets tiresome. Like, the men are in their foxholes hiding and they're like, okay, you guys are gonna attack us. We get it. Quit launching artillery and just come get us.
Yeah, and when, you know, when shit happens and adrenaline goes up, right? This is the point where you're like, all of your senses are like, whatever senses that might come in the way gets turned off, like worry and shit. You're not worried in that way, like, you know, what if this, what if that, all that shit. You're just focusing on now. When adrenaline goes down, it will go really down just to like even things out. This is the time you start to have anxiety and shit. So if the situation hasn't changed, which is didn't because artillery was still going on and their drilling goes down, this is a time like some kind of like panic and anxiety seeps in, like what the fuck, what if this is it, and like what if we die here and shit like that. Like, these thoughts will naturally come. I guess they would train you for that. I don't know if they would train you or not, because it's like, you know, like people are just getting trained like faster and faster, and I don't know
already. But the artillery just keeps coming. Like, it feels like it takes an entire day for this artillery to finally stop. Once the artillery fire finally stops, Lieutenant Bauk gets out of his foxhole to assess the situation. He looks down on Lanzerath and realizes all this artillery fire has only been hitting their wood line right on top of them and the one corner of Lanzerath where those four forward observers were, which means Belgian shoe guy was definitely a spy that fucked him over. And right as Bauk is putting that together, the 55 anti-tank guys are loading up in their jeeps and they are peeling off, just straight up leaving. Bauk is obviously kind of pissed off that he didn't give him a heads up. I mean, they ran a phone line out to him, so they had a direct line of communication, but the artillery barrage must have taken it out. In fact, the artillery barrage has taken out all their phone lines, so now all they have is radio. So Bauk radios over to this anti-tank unit and they're like, yeah, we got orders to go over to this next town. That's where we're headed. At which point Bauk is like, okay, well, I can't do anything without you guys. Like, I have a 50 caliber machine gun and some small arms. If they roll up with a tank, we're done. We can't do anything. So Bauk gets on the radio with HQ, tells them the same thing. Hey, the 55 anti-tank guys left. We have nothing that can combat a tank. Do you want...
I mean, yeah, they were there. What if tanks come? And now, like, what are they supposed to do? Play chess? Okay, I have a machine gun, but tanks, like, I can't do shit. It's not anti-tank material ammo or whatever. What do I want to do with that shit? This is not like video game. It's like if the video game stage was like, you have like machine gun and it does no damage. Wait a minute, there must be something here, right? Nowhere this is how the map for stage. Yeah, that's how it was. That's the level. You're screwed.
Want us to retreat back to a different position too? What do you want us to do? And Bauk is ordered to hold his position at all costs. Right around this time, the four forward observers that were down in town come up the hill. They're going to be joining forces with the INR platoon because their position got absolutely pounded by artillery. So it is now Lieutenant Bauk, the INR platoon, and four forward observers for a total of 22 men defending Lanzerath and the road running through it. So the forward observers get settled into their new fighting positions, and as soon as that happens, hundreds of German soldiers descend upon Lanzerath. I mean, a shit ton. Luckily, it's very clear that these guys are not moving tactically. They're kind of just moseying through the town. They're not expecting any resistance. They think that the Americans have either been taken out by that artillery barrage or that they all retreated after the fact.
Yeah, they must have like, okay, no way anybody's staying there, right? We just bombed the shit out of that thing for like all entire day, right? Either things are dead or clearly they walked away, because why would they not? It's not some important place or something. Right, it's just a road, road area. They could just retreat back. They didn't realize that people are still there, and they're just like simply just like walking, talking to each other. Yeah, this is gonna be insane, right? Sudden machine gun fire and shit like that.
Fact. But as they start getting closer and closer to the ridge where the INR platoon is, Bauk finally makes out these aren't just German soldiers, these are German paratroopers carrying the new FG-42 assault rifle. Great, so not only are they outnumbered like 50-1, but these are also an elite infantry unit that have fancy new weapons. Perfect. In reality, and luckily for Bauk, a lot of these paratroopers were new recruits and weren't quite trained up to the paratrooper standard that the Germans had previously had earlier in the war, but Bauk doesn't know that, and he's still kind of shitting his pants about it. And honestly, it really doesn't matter that much, because even with that being said, it's still 500-22. So seeing how vastly outnumbered they are, Lieutenant Bauk is like, okay, it's my turn to call in artillery fire. He hops on the radio, he calls for fire right on top of this massive formation of Germans, and they radio back and tell him, sorry, you're outside of the priority zone. We're taking attack from all over the place, and you're just not a big priority right now, so you're just gonna have to live without it. Now, Bauk doesn't say it over the radio, obviously, but at this point, he's just kind of like, so let me get this straight. I need to hold this ground at all costs because it's of vital importance, but it's also not vitally important enough for you to throw some artillery fire my way to help me out in my 22-500 battle. Okay, great, perfect. You know what?
This is just stupid. Okay, it was about tanks, so they took out the anti-tank thing. Like, okay, we're gonna take it, we need it somewhere else. What if tank come? Okay, you can't even give me artillery, but you want me to defend this place. Should I retreat? Israel was like, oh, should I retreat? Like, what do you want me to do? Die here? 22 versus 500? That's just insane, man.
I still have the element of surprise, so I've got that going for me at the very least. And as soon as he has that thought, he sets the radio down, and one of his INR platoon guys goes, sir, you might want to look at this. He turns, looks down at Lanzerath, and there's a German officer talking to a young blonde girl, and the young blonde girl is pointing directly at them, at which point Bauk is like, fuck. And then immediately...
that the household, right? Oh, by the way, where are those Americans? Oh, yeah, you're one of them. It's just there. Okay, I guess. And that guy is just like, fuck me.
All the Germans scatter and take cover. So now he has nothing, and it's just straight up 22-500.
What are you thinking? I think we're about fixing to get into a pretty good gunfight.
Wait a minute, don't they have like that Jeep with a machine gun? Just Far Cry this shit, I don't know. There you go.
Moments later, the Germans just bum rush the hill that the INR platoon are on top of. About midway up this hill, there's this barbed wire fence. They didn't put it up, it'd been there forever. But none of the Germans even make it there. The INR platoon is just picking them off one by one. Remember, every single one of them is an expert marksman. And these guys are just out in the open, running up a hill. They don't stand a chance. The INR platoon ends up driving the Germans back. Obviously, they fall back, they regroup. Bauk is going from foxhole to foxhole, redistributing ammunition, checking on all of his guys. Everybody's okay. They've repelled the first wave of the Germans. They're probably going to get flanked now. There's nobody out there. If they get flanked, they're screwed. At this point, it feels like they've been awake for 3 days, but in reality, it's only like 9 o'clock in the morning. And like I said, they're just sitting there waiting for this flank to come. They're just going to fight till the bitter end. That's all they can really do. And they sit there and they wait and they wait. And minutes turn into hours, and then the Germans launch another attack at 11 a.m., but they're not flanking them. They're using the same strategy. They're just running up the hill, trying to run through machine gun fire like it's World War I. At this point, Bauk is like, well, this is fantastic news. Finally, somebody's given me and the INR platoon a break, and it turns out it's the enemy. So they mow them down again, push them back again. Shortly after that, a couple of Germans approach under a white flag. Bauk goes up there to meet them. The Germans just want to be able to scoop up some of their dead and wounded off the side of this ridge. And Bauk is like, sure, go ahead. You do that. We won't fire on you. Go ahead, get your guys. Bauk retreats, hoping that when he's captured, they're going to extend him the same goodwill. So the medics come out. They scoop up all the medics under the hill. The INR platoon lets them do it, just as Bauk said they would. Everything's fine and dandy. And Bauk is kind of thinking to himself, like, all right, I have the high ground. I have fortified machine gun positions. They've figured it out after the first two runs. They're definitely not going to try a full frontal assault where I have the high ground again.
Don't try it. High ground.
But the German stormtroopers, I mean the paratroopers, are like,
you underestimate my power.
At 1 p.m., they launch a full frontal assault for a third time. And predictably so, they got the exact same results they got the first two times. The INR platoon guys described it as shooting clay pigeons at the state fair.
Whoops, I'm gonna grab that there. High ground.
Wait, are you f***ing robbing me?
Then the same thing happens. The Germans fall back, they regroup, 3 p.m.
I think the blonde girl basically told them, like, they're just like 10, 15 or something like that, right? She probably just told them like 15, 20, whatever. That's, and they're like, okay, we're 500. I don't need to think about strategy, just run towards them type of shit. There's no way they're gonna like give these paratroopers this like fancy gun and just like all of them are morons. That can't be the case, right? So I think it's just that, like, oh come on, just like 15, 20, we can take them. We're 500, we don't need strategy.
They launch another full frontal attack. They get repelled again, except during this attack, they sent out so many men that the 50 caliber machine gun actually got burnt up because they were having to run it so hard to mow down so many Germans. In addition to that, they're also out of ammunition for the BARs, and Bauk's radio got shot in the middle of this firefight, so now they have no communication whatsoever. So now, Bauk's making all the decisions. They've held this position longer than anybody could have ever expected them to. It's time to get the fuck out of here. So he goes, they sabotage all the Jeeps, and as soon as it gets dark out, they're gonna slip away into the forest at night and make their way back to headquarters on foot. Now, that sounds a little bit crazy, like why wouldn't you wanna drive? But in reality, there's probably Germans all over the road, and this is the INR platoon. That's their whole MO, is sneaking around in the woods and going unnoticed.
It's not crazy, right? Even in video games, you don't want to make noises with vehicles and shit because you will like alert people, right? So yeah, that just makes sense. How fucked up it is, like, video games have become so good, advanced, like, most people see that, like, who are played, you know, many video games, like, yeah, it makes sense, right? I would do the same thing in a video game, wouldn't start an engine. There you go. Skills,
this
I guess.
This is their best shot at getting out of this. So they sabotage the Jeeps, they get ready to step off, and right at dusk as they're about to leave, the Germans attack them from their flank. They get into a firefight, but the INR platoon runs completely out of ammunition, and they get overrun by the Germans. And eventually, the Germans just roll up to the foxholes, and they yell down, you can come out or we're gonna send a grenade in. So foxhole by foxhole, the entire INR platoon surrenders. And as they come out, they're all shot up, blown up, they're all hit with shrapnel, gunshot wounds. Bauk took a bullet to the leg. Nobody's doing that great. But with the exception of one forward observer by the name of Billy Queen, they're all still alive, which is pretty incredible for a 22 to 500 firefight. So the Germans get the entire INR platoon and the three remaining FOs all lined up, and it becomes very apparent that the Germans are gonna kill them. They're standing there with a machine gun, and right as this guy is about to let fire with this machine gun, a German officer comes running up the hill screaming, and next thing they know, the entire INR platoon is getting escorted down this hill into Lanzerath. Next thing they know, they're all getting funneled into the cafe in Lanzerath. The Germans Germans are digging through their pockets, they're confiscating anything that's good, and the Germans confiscate all the cigarettes, and as they take all the cigarettes, they walk around and give the Americans one last cigarette, like, okay, maybe they are still gonna kill us. I have no idea what's going on. Either way, now they're all just sitting in the cafe, having their last cigarette, blown up, bleeding with bullet holes in them, and it's just dead quiet. Bauk said the loudest thing in that room was the second hand on the cuckoo clock in the corner, and it was ungodly loud. It was so quiet that in between the noises of the second hand on that cuckoo...
Yeah, that anxiety and like seriousness makes your hearing really high on alert, right? I don't know the scenario, but you know, I remember it like as a kid being in some scenario. I don't know what was the reason, but yeah, just like your hearing becomes like really intense and you hear the smallest thing. It's just like, fuck me, just be over already type of shit, right? So yeah, it just makes sense. Like, we're like, oh God, we're gonna die. And just like secondhand, it's just like, you get angry, right? When people are like just angry, they get angry over the smallest thing, like, shut the fuck up. Why is that thing making sound type of shit? This is some intense psychological thing going on, man.
Cuckoo clock. Bauk could actually hear the Germans, the superior master race, across town in their aid station screaming from their injuries. Meanwhile, him and all of his men are just sitting in the cafe, dead quiet, stone face, having a cigarette. It's like the biggest cool guy moment ever. So the Iron Arc platoon finishes their last cigarette and then they just sit there and they sit there and they sit there and they sit there. And then eventually Bauk is just trying to think to himself over that annoying ass cuckoo clock in the corner, and he just starts to get really down. He's not happy with how things went, right? He spent 6 years of his life training for this, and he goes into combat, and the first time he really goes into combat, he gets the best guys that the 99th Infantry had to offer. They let him pick the best of the best, and he took them into battle, and in one day, he got all of them captured and most likely killed, and it's all on him. Or at least that's how he felt at the time. And he just continues to sit there.
I mean, then again, that's how the World Wars was, right? Like, most people only got one chance, right? When shit went fucked up type of way. That's how fucked up World Wars were, right? In World War I, just in order to keep the pressure in the trenches, they literally brought all these recruits just so they can go into the trench and die by machine gun fire. That's all their job was. There was no like hope, like you might do something. There was nothing to do. All there was like, if you know, keep the Germans there, pressure there, that's it. So in like other place, forgot the name of that place, the pressure can be relieved because that was like kind of important place. So they just literally brought people from Britain and everywhere, like, okay, go into the machine gun fire. That's your, how fucked up that is. Like, you're literally sending people there to die just to buy time. So yeah, World Wars were that kind of fucked up, like, okay. It's insane when you really think about it.
For hours, just loathing himself in the silence and the noise of that fucking cuckoo clock in the corner that just keeps ticking and ticking and ticking. And he's just sitting there and he's sitting there, and then the fucking bird comes out again and honks, and it's 10 p.m. And suddenly he has this memory of when he was 14 years old and his Aunt Mildred, who used to read palms, she read his palm when he was 14, and she told him that if he lived to be 21, he'd have a long, happy life. And he's about 2 hours away from turning 21. What? At this point, he can't believe that this is the dumb shit that he's thinking about, but that's what he's thinking about. So he sits.
Yeah, but it's not dumb shit. He's about to die, and the whole prophecy of whatever it is, if you turn 20, we're gonna live a happy life. Clearly doesn't look happy, which means he's gonna die in less than 2 hours. That's what he's probably thinking there. Damn, that's heavy.
There, and he waits, and more time passes, and sure enough, midnight hits, and suddenly he just feels this relief, like, can't get me now. I'm gonna make it. And not a minute later, some high-ranking German officer comes storming into the cafe, yelling at all the other Germans. This guy's not like all the other German military guys around here. He's not standard German military. This guy's SS. He's dressed from head to toe in leather. He's got the German dead skull on his hat. He's got the Knight's Iron Cross around his neck, the second highest award for valor in the German military. This dude is super important, and he is super fucking pissed off right now. Now, Bauk doesn't know it at the time, but this SS officer is yelling at all these other German officers, like, why are you guys stopped? Why aren't you continuing to advance? We're on a very strict timetable. What the fuck is going on? So these German officers explain to this SS guy, like, hey, there's a massive American army in this wood line. They've got tanks, they've got machine guns. We're not gonna go fight them at night. They've been fucking us up all day long. We finally captured their forward scout element. So they wait until there's enough light to actually go outside. Like 4 a.m., the Germans send out a bunch of scouts into the wood line. They don't find
Oh my God. Oh my God. So these 22 fucked them up so bad that they thought there's a whole army there, and this is just like scout that they captured. What the fuck? And they're like, oh, let's wait it out at night. We have to fight in the morning. Is that what's happening? That's insane.
Anything, because there's nothing there to find, and they have to come to the realization that 22 dudes with small arms have been fucking them up.
Imagine that they're speaking German, they realize, and they suddenly look at them, and they're like, what the fuck is happening? That is intense shit.
Past 22 hours, and they're all incredibly embarrassed. So the Germans take off, hightailing it down this road, half tracks, tanks, and then Lyle Bauck and the rest of the INR platoon are all getting sent to POW camps. Unfortunately, because Bauck is an officer, he's going to get separated from the rest of the guys, and they're going to separate POW camps. From here, you guys know the drill. POW camp is absolutely horrible, the worst possible thing to have to live through. He's starved to death. There's diseases, living in close proximity with other sick people, and as
starved to death, horrible conditions. Probably part of experimentation, right? POW's stories are so fucked up. Even the children, I mean, what the fuck, right? All those Germans, you know, Nazi stories of how, like, you know, those fucked up scientists, and I'm forgetting the name of that a-hole, right? The scientists, I don't know, but yeah, who did these horrible experiments on, like, everybody, kids and every, oh, that's just fucked up. The more I hear about it, the more chills I get. And there's a point I'm like, let's not hear about that in more detail. I just stopped. Because I was keep imagining, keep processing, and it just like terrified me, like, what the fuck? Because I don't just hear things. I don't just try to process things. I try to imagine it as best I can. And the more I hear it, that's how I'm always am, right? Whenever I hear something. And it just terrified me when I heard all those stories, man. World War II was really fucked up.
War progresses. At one point, there is actually a prison break. He ends up getting recaptured, stuck back into a POW camp. And as the war continues to progress, for some reason, they keep moving him from POW camp to POW camp. And he doesn't know it at the time, but what's actually happening is the Germans are losing the war, and all the German POW camps on the eastern half of Europe are starting to move all their POWs and themselves to the western side, because if these Germans are going to have to surrender to an allied force, they absolutely want to surrender to the Americans, the British, and the Canadians, because if they surrender to them, it's a court date, and if they surrender to the Red Army, it's going to be an execution. His final POW camp is in Moosburg, and while he's there, a bunch of SS teenagers, like radicalized 16, 17, 18-year-olds with submachine guns that have German officer rank, roll into this POW camp, and they want to execute all the POWs, including Bauck. At which point, the normal German army, the Wehrmacht, are like, no, you're not executing all the prisoners. Those are our bargaining chips to turn over to the Allies so we don't get killed. So, absolutely not. And there's this huge fight between the SS and the Wehrmacht, which became more and more common as the war progressed. And ultimately, the Wehrmacht won that argument, and they ended up keeping everybody alive. So, Bauck got pretty lucky on that one. From there, Lyle Bauck remains at that POW camp till the end of World War II. When he is finally released, he weighs 114 pounds and has contracted hepatitis. He is essentially on his deathbed, and he spends months in the hospital. Thankfully, Lyle Bauck does end up recovering. He makes it back home, and from there, he's like, what, 22 at this point? So he's trying to figure out what he wants to do with the rest of his life, and he's like, I mean, I've already dedicated so much of my time to being in the military. Maybe I should just go back and be full-time Army, and he's considering doing that, and then the paperwork comes through, and the Army fucked him over on his back pay and his leave that he had accrued while he was a POW, and he, you know, challenged him on it, and he's like, hey, you did my back pay wrong. You paid me out as a supply NCO when I was actually a officer in the infantry in combat the entire time and serving as a POW. I'd like to be paid as an officer, not as an NCO. And the Army's like, don't care, fuck off. So he's like furious, like the Army has done nothing but treat this guy poorly, right? Like, couldn't get artillery fire when he needed it, can't get back pay. And he...
look, I get it, wars are fucked up, money problems, I understand that as well, logistically you understand that as well, but your own people that you send there, who was in this camp where enemy captured them, like, there is a limit, like, how far should we think this, more statistically or mathematically, and where, like, we need to understand the human element, right? You need to balance those things, right? There should be a line, like, okay, this guy was captured because he was doing our thing, he was following orders, at least we shouldn't fuck him over on this one, right? We can manage money issues somewhere else, logistics somewhere else, not here. But I see in military all the time, veterans get fucked over like that. Like, really?
He's just like, screw this, I'm done with the army. I don't want anything to do with it anymore. Understandably so, from his point of view. From there, he kind of hangs around town, meets his high school sweetheart, Lucy, ends up marrying her, trying to decide what he wants to do for a career. And one of the things that helped him recover from all his injuries from the war was actually a chiropractor. So that inspires him to go off and become a chiropractor himself. And from there, he just kind of gets to live happily ever after, just like his Aunt Mildred predicted when she read his palm. For 20 years, he never talked about what he did during World War II. Why would he? He thought he was a failure. He thought that he got given the chance to assemble the best men the 90s.
Okay, that prediction is so insane, right? Because they would have, like, Nazis would have shot them if they realized that there were only 22 of them. But they didn't shot them because they thought there was a bigger army there. So his 2 hours till his birthday was still clock was going because they realized that there's more bigger army there, right? And after that time went on and they realized, wait a minute, there's no bigger army there. That's when they like send them POW, like enough of this shit. Because otherwise they would have just like spot of the moment just would have shot them right there at night. Right? So in a way they kind of worked, right? Because those 2 hours mattered. Because before that 2 hour they would definitely shot them. But because 2 hours went away and the night went away, in the morning they're like, okay, go to POW, whatever.
89th Infantry Division had to offer, and he led them into battle and got them captured and served out the majority of his time in theater as a prisoner of war. It was nothing to brag about, or at least that's how he felt. So he never really talked about it. And then one day in 1965, he got a letter from one of his men. After 20 years, the United States government was finally putting out extensive volumes of what happened during World War II, and one of the volumes was dedicated to this major German offensive in 1944, December 16th, 1944 specifically, called the Battle of the Bulge. Adolf Hitler had ordered a massive Blitzkrieg-style offensive where they were going to split the American and British forces in half.
That's what he stopped. Oh my God, I even forgot that. What? This is insane shit. Wait a minute, the US Army knew this shit and they still screwed him over and like didn't reward him or something? Like, come on.
Seizing Antwerp, cutting off the supplies, crushing the British and the Canadians, and forcing the Americans to sign a peace treaty. In order for this plan to have any success, it was critical that they had the element of surprise, and because of that, German High Command in the days leading up to the Battle of the Bulge Offensive ordered that none of the German scouts were to go out without a German scout dog that was specifically trained to lead the scouts by 100 yards. That way, none of them got caught, because if a single scout got caught and got interrogated and gave away this battle strategy, it would ruin the entire thing. That's the dog that they shot on December 13th.
What?
And that also explains all the ski marks and everything else hundreds of yards behind the dog. The artillery barrage that they survived before the paratroopers attacked, that was the largest artillery barrage of World War II, with over 1,600 artillery pieces firing on the American front for over 90 minutes. That pissed off SS officer that showed up at the cafe at midnight, that was Joachim Piper, the commander of the 1st Panzer Division. The 1st Panzer Division was the lead element of the 6th Panzer Army, which at this point in time was Germany's premier armored unit that was hand-selected by Hitler himself to have the most important role of the entire military operation. The 6th Panzer Army, being comprised of almost 5,000 men and 600 vehicles, tanks, and armored half-tracks, was supposed to be the first element to cross the River Meuse and head straight to Antwerp to cut the Allied forces in half. They were the spearhead of this entire offensive, and Joachim Piper's 1st Panzer Division was the tip of that spear, and the reason he was so pissed off that night was because the paratroopers getting stopped by the INR platoon created a traffic jam behind them that he was stuck in, and he was 18 hours behind schedule. This German attack was so hasty, they weren't going to be able to rely on their own supply lines. They had to rely on capturing Allied supplies to be able to continue this attack, including fuel. And since they were 18 hours behind schedule, the Allies were able to adopt new defensive positions, not leave any supplies behind, and the entire 1st Panzer Division would run out of fuel. The weather would break.
So you telling me that whatever these people did, that delay was critical. It was literally critical strike, critical shot, like critical damage. That's what that was. So military knows this shit and they still like screwed him over with the pay and everything, realizing how instrumental this guy and his people were. Or at the time they didn't know, like even like they realized later what just happened. Shouldn't they just like, you know, like reward him, whatever, like. I get it, he got captured, but what he did was instrumental. So give him some kind of medal or something, reward him in some way. Come on.
Allied planes would take the sky, they would attack, and the entire 1st Panzer Division would never cross the River Meuse. The INR platoon and 4 forward observers quite literally blunted the spear of the entire German offensive. 22 men stood in the pocket and stuffed the largest blitz the world has ever seen at the line of scrimmage. These 22 men may be responsible for changing the entire outcome of World War II, and at this point in time, nobody really knew anything about it. Some of the military historians knew that something happened over there, but nobody knew what happened, and it's because Buch and all of his men got captured after the war. There were no after-action reports. They never got around to filling out all those papers. They just got sent to the hospital, got patched up, and got sent home. Nobody knew what actually happened. So Buch, 20 years after the fact, writes into his old commanding officer, and then a couple of months later, he never hears anything back, but a silver star just shows up in the mail, only for him. And it's not really what he's looking for, because he figures the rest of his men probably feel the same way he did. They trained just as hard as he did. They went out, they got the same fight, and they ended up getting caught too. They probably feel just like he does, and he wants to make sure that he gets them the recognition. He wants to be the good leader to his men that he never had. For years, he writes letters and petitions and does interviews and talks to journalists about what his men did that day. And for years, nothing really happens. And years turned into decades. And after two more decades, he finally breaks through. And in 1981, his men get the recognition they deserve. The INR platoon would retroactively be...
Okay, damn.
He awarded 4 Distinguished Service Crosses, 5 Silver Stars, and 10 Bronze Stars with V device, and the entire platoon will be awarded the Presidential Unit Citation. If you don't know, a Presidential Unit Citation is the highest award a unit can receive, and it's usually given out to companies or battalions for major battles or something huge. It's very strange for an element as small as a platoon to be given this award. In fact, they were the only platoon of World War II to be given the Presidential Unit Citation. And with that, they became the most decorated platoon of World War II. Thank you for watching. The best way to support the channel is go buy some merch over at thefatelectrician.com. Quack bang, out. It's pretty wild those guys changed the entire course of world history and didn't even know it until 20 years after the fact. I don't know. Maybe there's a message or something in that.
Yep, there you go. That is some insane level shit. Like, they didn't realize early on, and then like decades later they all got recognition. That is, oh my god, I even forgot that where this was going. I'm not, this is how good factors and stories are. By the very end, like, okay, well, okay, yeah, this is happening, but obviously at the start he said like how Hitler was doing this plan, he was instrumental. I even forgot that, but yeah, that's what they stopped. That is insane. I mean, obviously, like, even if then this didn't happen, not that Nazi Germany was ever going to win, but yeah, they would have done much heavier damage if they were successful. They would eventually would have like stormed out, because yeah, like resource problem was still there. No way Nazi Germany was going to win, but maybe they would have like do enough damage that they come to some kind of like a agreement or like peace talk, which is fucked up, right? Nazis doing peace talk and like basically walking away is really fucked up, right? Because if they're in the strength forces and in any way. So, yeah, these people really turn the tide. That is insane. Just 22 men, right? And that level of insane level of artillery barrage they weather. They were so powerful that fucking all 500 thought this big army there, because nowhere 22 did all this shit. That is insane, man. Alright, well, another badass story from Fatrison about World War II. 22 versus 500. America's defense standard. Lanzerath Ridge, I guess, and he's silent. Bunch of fire. If you like my next one, don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you next time.